everybody. We will
rock you.
Welcome to ESTEC, the technical heart of the European Space Agency here in Noordwijk, the Netherlands. It is with great pleasure that we host today's Asteroid Day press conference. Welcome. My name is Ninja Menning. I'm the head of the ESTEC Communication Unit. The European Space Agency shapes Europe's capabilities in space. Together with our 22 member states, we make sure that the investment in space brings benefits to the citizens of Europe and the world. Today is a truly, truly global event. We have 60 nations connected here at ESTEC via live stream, via video. We're using multimedia platforms to bring together speakers from all across the world. For the journalists in the room and on the live stream, a few notes. We will run through all the presentations first, and then at the end of the press conference, you can ask questions. For the journalists on the live stream, it will be possible to ask questions via Twitter with the hashtag AsteroidDay2016. And you can also send an email to pr@asteroidday.org if you have a question. The press kit can be found on the asteroidday.org website. Thank you. Enjoy the press conference. And let me now give the word to MC Dr. Stuart Clark, esteemed science writer, author, and contributor to The Guardian. Thank you, Stuart.
Thank you, Ninja. On behalf of Asteroid Day, may I say a very, very big thank you to the European Space Agency for hosting us here today. And may I extend a very warm welcome to all of you here at ESTEC and our global audience across the world via the internet. As you heard, we'll be hearing today from a panel of speakers, all eminent and all with something unique to say about the need to study asteroids and to develop our understanding of the potential threat that they pose. The first thing I'm going to do is to introduce you to the co-founders of Asteroid Day. And the first one of those people is one of those people who needs no introduction whatsoever. And so traditionally, I'm going to give him one anyway. It's Dr. Brian May, astrophysicist and Queen guitarist. Dr. May couldn't be with us here today, but he's recorded a number of messages, videos, and we're going to hear the first one of those right now.
The first Asteroid Day last year, 2015, was a huge success, and it made a start in raising global awareness of a possible asteroid strike. The next Asteroid Day is June the 30th, 2016, and we're encouraging people to mount their own events on that day and make Asteroid Day truly global. So schools, universities, museums, we have lots of material on the website, and please get into it and help to raise global awareness.
Thank you, Brian. The next person is the other co-founder of Asteroid Day, and that's German filmmaker Grig Richters. Grig became interested in asteroids and the threat that they pose to the Earth while he was making his movie 51 Degrees North about the last days before a giant asteroid strike. Grig, welcome.
Thank you, Stuart. It is a great honor to be here at the European Space Agency, ESTEC,
And I would like to thank the European Space Agency for hosting us, making all of this possible. There's been so much work that went into this, and it's truly an amazing effort. So thank you so much. So I'm gonna keep myself short, but basically, Asteroid Day was started by Dr. Brian May, Rusty Schweickart, the famous Apollo 9 astronaut and planetary scientist, and Danica Remy. And what Astro Day is really about is about raising awareness about the potential asteroid impact through educational programs around the world. And it is fantastic, it is amazing that in our second year, and we haven't actually had our second Asteroid Day yet because it's June 30th, 2016, we have over 20 partners, global, educational, from all around the world. Last year, we had our first Asteroid Day, June 30th, 2015, and the 100X Declaration was originally signed by over 100 notable scientists, astronauts, entertainers, and business leaders, and is now signed by almost 200 notable signers, and by thousands of public, private citizens, concerned citizens, from over 100 nations. And so this year, our aim is to continue where we started off last year, create more events. Last year we had over 150 self-organized events. So we want to increase the number of global events. We want to increase the level of education. And let me be clear, this is not about fear-mongering. This is about being aware that there is a potential threat, but it's also about understanding better about where we are from. Where do we come from? That's I think a very intriguing and a very deep question. And I think that's all part of Asteroid Day. So it's not about the fear. There's some amazing people in the field working on this day in, day out. And that's one of our roles as a global community, to also put a spotlight on these individuals that are dedicating themselves to this and helping them, you know, get more funds for their research. And just, we need to understand that, you know, there is something up in the skies, and it is important for us as citizens of this planet to understand that better. So today we will hear from our new partners, from returning partners, from new signers, from returning signers, and I'm being asked to get off the stage. So I will give it back to Dr. Stuart Clark, and thank you again for being here.
Thank you, Greg. Well, as you've heard, Asteroid Day is a global endeavor. This is something that cannot be done by one country alone. And so we're going to hook up with supporters around the world. And it's time now to go over to Silicon Valley in California. And we're going to see if Dr. Ed Liu is there. Now, Ed is a 3-times shuttle astronaut. He lived on the International Space Station for 7 months. He's a former Google executive and now CEO of B612. Ed, welcome.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. And I wanted to tell folks. Why I personally am involved in planetary. And why the B612 Foundation. Throughout my career, I've been lucky to see the kinds of things that people can do when we work together. As you mentioned, I was lucky enough to spend many months orbiting Earth on board the International and I see the kinds of things that humans can do when we work positively upwards. Now, we have the opportunity as power of our brains to change the evolution of our solar system, and that means protecting the third planet from the sun, our planet from the sun, hit by major asteroids from this point on. Now, astronomy has always been about observations of the cosmos to predict the future. But now we're at the point where we have the technology to change the future. If there is a large asteroid that is going to impact the Earth, we have the capability to find it, track it, know in advance, and suddenly change its orbit so that it does not hit the Earth. So the field of planetary defense has come a long way in the last 15 years, and we are on the verge of actually being able to protect the Earth with brand new telescopes that are coming online soon. I'm delighted that ESA has partnered with Asteroid Day, and they're increasingly becoming a major player in planetary defense. In fact, the ESA and NASA proposed IDA mission to test the technology to actually deflect an asteroid would be a huge step forward. So I'm delighted to be here as part of the Asteroid Day festivities, and I'm looking forward to hearing more from the other panel.
Thank you very much, Ed. Well, from one side of America to another, and now it's time to go to Washington, D.C., and here we're going to hear from Dr. Tom Jones. Now, Tom is a four times astronaut. I'm not sure if there's some game of one-upmanship going on here. But he's also a planetary scientist, and he's the chair of the Association of Space Explorers Near Earth Object Committee. Over to you, Tom.
Well, hi, everyone. Good morning. It's Tom Jones here, chairman of the Association of Space Explorers Committee on Near Earth Objects. And those are the small bodies, of course, which we're talking about today, which pose a threat to Earth. Now, the Association of Space Explorers is the international nonprofit professional and educational organization of over 400 flown astronauts and cosmonauts, like Ed, like Doran Panariu, who we'll hear from in a moment, from over 37 nations. We think that asteroid impacts are an ongoing global hazard, which threatens our society and ultimately civilization itself. And because we're an international organization, our astronaut members have seen with their own eyes from space the graphic evidence of the scars left on Earth and the Moon by cosmic impacts. And knowing that Earth will certainly be struck again by a dangerous asteroid, the Association of Space Explorers takes the position that space technology, coupled with global cooperation, provides a means to prevent a future asteroid impact. ASE supports the UN, United Nations promoted cooperation between space agencies, work that includes asteroid discovery, tracking, warning, and mission planning. And we've had a role in bringing those cooperative efforts together and promoting them today. Now, bringing space technology to bear to deflect dangerous asteroids and bringing nations together to cooperate in asteroid detection and deflection will require widespread public support. So if we cooperate and plan ahead, we only need modest resources to detect rogue asteroids and mount a deflection campaign, and that's compared to the cost of absorbing an impact. A great and necessary first step, we think, is to launch an infrared space telescope to accelerate the discovery of a million or more asteroids that can cause serious damage to Earth. That's where Asteroid Day comes in. It's an annual event that helps educate the public to the potential dangers of the asteroid hazard and the real solutions we can employ to detect asteroids, predict collisions, and work together to prevent an impact. Now, Space Explorer members are active in helping educate the public on the hazard, and we've actively contributed to the first Asteroid Day last year. We'll continue to communicate to the public and to policy makers how best to provide Earth with an asteroid insurance policy. So, in conclusion, the Association of Space Explorers supports Asteroid Day 2016. We'll join in the global events this year and invite the public support in acting to stop a future damaging impact. Over to you, Stuart. Thank you.
Asteroids pose a risk to the Earth. It's a small risk in any one year, but it's a higher risk, obviously, the further we look ahead. The only way we can ensure that people and governments remain aware of these long-term risks, which cumulatively are serious, is through the public being aware of them. And the value of Asteroid Day, which of course started last year, is that it's a way of raising public awareness of this issue and therefore of putting it a bit higher on the agenda so that when politicians and others in a position to deploy funds for scientific purposes make their decisions, they're aware that there is a serious case for doing more than has been done up to now in order to do what we can to remove the asteroid risks, to survey the sky for asteroids that might have orbits crossing the Earth's orbit, and to explore technology that could be used to deflect one that was on course to hit us. So what is very important is to ensure that the public is aware of this threat, because unlike, say, earthquakes, which everyone is aware of, many people are not aware that there is a risk coming to us from space. And Asteroid Day is something which has a great educational value in widening awareness of this, and as a byproduct, of course, making people aware that what's up in the sky is part of our environment and is interesting in its own right.
Well, I was very glad that someone decided to create, to establish Asteroid Day, because it seemed to me to be a very important instrument of public education. In other words, bringing to public attention the fact of asteroids and the role they played so far in human history and the role they could play in the future. But by and large, these can affect society as a whole. And I think that the reason you don't want to scaremonger is you could scaremonger among a lot of things, but in our society at the moment, quite a lot of things are going wrong. And you read the newspapers every day or listen to the radio, you realize that what is that there are a lot of things going wrong. But this is catastrophically wrong. Therefore, you don't want to scare people when probably no one around at the moment, certainly not of my great age, is liable to have the effects of an impact from space. But it could happen. And if there's a real risk of it happening, then we must do something about it. And I think the great thing is that we should pay for the necessary research to establish the boundaries of a hit of this kind. And having done that, to see how we can develop technologies which will push it out of orbit. And that's really what we were focusing on doing.
So now it's time to welcome one of our new partners for this year, for Asteroid Day 2016, and it's the Romanian Space Agency. Here to talk about their involvement is Dorin Prunariu. And Dorin is the first and so far the only Romanian astronaut. He's also a member of the Association of Space Explorers Committee for Near Earth Objects, and he's a former chair of the United Nations Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space. Dorin, thank you for joining us.
Hello, nice to join you. I'm the premises of the Romanian Space Agency, but at the same time representing the Association of Space Explorers and the promotion of the Asteroid Day by this organization. As a short history, maybe you know that in 2005, October 14, BBC issued a new open letter to the international community and form its International Committee on Near Earth Objects by the initiative and under the leadership of Apollo 9 astronaut Rusty Schweickart. A few weeks after, AC NEO Committee sent a letter to Action in 14 of the United Nations Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space. Through its International Expert Panel on Asteroid Threat Mitigation, AC quickly produced a decision-making proposal and a set of recommendations to help the international community address the impact threat. The plan went to the United Nations in 2008. The report, Asteroid Threat, a Call for Global Response, became a working document of the UN on Near-Earth Objects. Rusty Schweickart, Franklin Chang-Diaz, I, and Tom Jones, who is now leading our ACNEO activity, represented the association at the work of the Action Team 14 and Near Earth Objects Working Group of the Scientific and Technical Subcommittee of COPUS. Today we already have two international structures defined and proposed by Near Earth Objects Working Group, in which AAC was an active member. These structures, I mean the International Asteroid Warning Network and Space Mission Planning Advisory Group, were agreed by COPUS member states and approved in the fall of 2013 by a resolution of the United Nations General Assembly. The Asteroid Day is a global awareness movement where people from around the world come together to learn about asteroids and what we can do to protect our planet, our families, communities, and future generations comes to complete the activity of existing organizations dealing with NEO. We consider that this very important movement should be adequately considered by the United Nations and approved by the United Nations General Assembly as an annual educational event that promotes public support for international response to the near-earth objects hazard. In this respect, we started to take the necessary official measures to reach this goal. AC is a COPOS observer member since 1993, and in the same time now, many of our members are part of the Asteroid Day. In this respect, we took the responsibility to represent this initiative at the level of the UN. During the next 2 weeks, in the framework of the scientific and training COPOS, on behalf of AC, I will present an official report on Asteroid Day and introduce a conference room paper to start the process of the recognition of this important initiative by the UN bodies. Last year, I had the opportunity to promote Asteroid Day in my community and in the region. Discovery has been a great partner to me in Romania, and we have been working closely together to bring Asteroid Day to life in my home country and in the neighboring countries. We continue this activity together in this area. Thank you.
Thank you, Dorin. Asteroid Day depends on its support, both from the general public and the many organizers that we partner with around the world. We have some of those organizations now to show you on the screen. Many of these organizations, all of them in fact, place a very high value on the spreading and the celebration of knowledge, the gathering of knowledge as a human endeavor, the shining result of human curiosity. And we're proud to be associated with all of these supporters and are constantly looking for new and other people to help us. Supporting us last year and returning this year is our media partner, the Discovery Channel. And so now I would like to invite Unai Iparagui, who is the director of Discovery Science, to tell us a little bit more.
Hello. So first of all, apologies for my name and especially my surname. And first of all, I would like to say thank you to the Asteroid Foundation and the European Space Agency for inviting us. We are very proud to be here. And secondly, that Discovery Science was the official media partner, as Stuart said, last year. And we are very proud to be again the official partner. But this year, we have also partnered with the European Space Agency. Now, you might know that Discovery Science is the only global broadcaster dedicated entirely to science and space. And for us and for our viewers, learning is really important, learning about the world and beyond. And science especially, especially is a really big thing for our viewers and our fans. They are very passionate about space. So when we first heard about Asteroid Day, we instantly knew that our viewers and fans would love it. So we got in touch with Grig, and a few weeks later, a partnership made in heaven, or space in this case, was born. And soon after, a few months after, in June, Discovery Science was all about Asteroid Day. So we dedicated 10 days in June to Asteroid Day programming. We had documentaries about the asteroid impact in Russia 3 years ago. We also have shows about the theory that links the extinction of dinosaurs and an asteroid impact. And we had a lineup of really fascinating and educational shows because, as I said, the educational role of Discovery Science is really important to us, but also to our viewers. That's why, as well as all the programming and all the promotion that we did on air, we worked with several science museums across Europe. And we organized lectures to teach and show a little bit more about asteroids. Viewers loved it. We loved it. It was an amazing experience and a really exciting initiative, and it was by far the most successful and most popular initiative on the channel last year. So we really couldn't be more excited to be partners again with Asteroid Day 2016. We are already working on it. Our programming team are putting together a really fascinating lineup of shows. We have also been working with the European Space Agency to organize a viewer competition, and we have a number of surprises that we can't reveal just yet. Unfortunately, the only bad thing that I'm not happy about is that we have to wait a few months because it is not happening until June. But we are sure that you will love it, and we are really excited to bring Asteroid Day to millions and millions of homes around the world. Thank you.
Greetings. Bill Nye here, CEO of the Planetary Society. We are honored to be included in this year's Asteroid Day. Our mission at the Planetary Society is to advance space science and exploration. And protecting the Earth from an asteroid or a comet coming in from space is a big part of that mission. As far as we can tell, the ancient dinosaurs did not have a space program, and it cost them. They all went extinct. We don't want to go that way. An asteroid or a comet is a real and important threat. We can protect the Earth. We can prevent the Earth from ever getting hit with an asteroid or a comet. We each have a role. Let's get to work.
Well, it's time now to introduce you to another one of our new partners, and it's Universe Awareness. And their vision is to use the beauty and the grandeur of the universe to inspire young children and encourage them to develop an interest in science and technology. And I'm very pleased to introduce to you their project manager, Tibise Senkatsing Nava.
Thank you, Stuart. For Universe Awareness, this partnership with Asteroid Day is very important. As Stuart said, our vision as Universe Awareness is to inspire every child with the cosmos and to use astronomy to engage them with science and technology, especially children from disadvantaged communities. Astronomy provides a unique perspective of our place in our solar system, in our galaxy, and in the universe. Understanding asteroids in particular is important to understanding our origins, the origins of our planet, and the origins of life in general. So Universe Awareness, in close collaboration with the European Space Agency and with Asteroid Day, is developing a set of educational activities for Asteroid Day that will be distributed throughout the networks of Universe Awareness and Space Awareness to over 60 countries. Teachers and educators in these countries will translate and localize these resources and will later also use these in the classroom around the 30th of June, Asteroid Day. The educational activities will include topics on the characteristics of asteroids, asteroid formation, their role in our solar system, and asteroid deflection missions that are currently under development. To ensure the quality of the resources, we will have teachers and educators and scientists review these activities. What we want to do is, as Universe Awareness, make sure that teachers, educators, and parents around the world have the best educational material available for Asteroid Day 2016. Thank you.
Thank you, Tibise. Well, now it's time to cross to India, and we have the first Indian to travel into space. He's Rakesh Sharma, and he's a former Indian Air Force pilot, and he flew on a Soyuz T-11 in April 1984. Rakesh, over to you.
Thank you, Stuart. Thank you, Stuart. Well, that we need to act to secure our future is so well stated in the Asteroid Day mission statement. All I can do is to really underline the fact that neither can we stop our planet from rotating about its axis, nor do we have the capability, well, at least not yet, to control the flight paths of zillions of asteroids that are wandering about the cosmos. And so we cannot predict Which country will be in the line of fire when impact happens? Simply stated, we ride on spaceship Earth, are equally exposed to such an event, and need to ensure that we have a viable collision avoidance system in place before being called upon to deal with the devastating effects of a strike. We and our future generations are at risk. It follows then that we need to collaborate to secure our collective future. One revenue model to sustain continued efforts that are required to put in place a viable collision avoidance could be, I guess, GDP-related sinking fund with all countries contributing. In effect, it would be a sort of a pay-forward scheme to secure our collective future, much like the life insurance premium many of us already pay. We have presently, or soon will have, the technology for such a solution. We only have to find the will, act in concert, and thereafter influence political opinion to make available funds for such a collaborative endeavor. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Rakesh. Now, when Asteroid Day was announced on December 3rd, 2014, over 100 notable scientists, astronauts, entertainers, one needy science writer, signed the 100X Declaration. On June 30th of last year, thousands of private citizens signed the declaration, and over 60 notable names have now also been added this year. These include Stephen Fry, comedian, astronaut Samantha Cristoforetti, Rosetta Project scientist Matt Taylor, Mexican astronomer Sylvia Torres-Piemba, Monty Python troupe member Terry Gilliam, the first Korean astronaut Soyeon Yi, and Nobel laureate Brian Schmidt, and many others. Now, for a full listing of everyone who signed, you can find that on the website asteroidday.org. And now we are having a small change to the program, which requires me to turn over a few pages. We're going back to America, this time to Albuquerque, New Mexico. And we're going to hear from Dr. Mark Boslow. And he's a physicist and a member of the technical staff at the Sandia National Laboratories. Mark, welcome.
Hi, greetings from Albuquerque. Can you hear me okay?
We can hear you very well, thank you.
Great. So 3 years ago this week, there was an event in Russia over the city of Chelyabinsk. I had the opportunity to go there, and I picked up this piece. This is a fragment of the Chelyabinsk meteor. It was a 20-meter diameter asteroid that came tearing into the Earth's atmosphere at about 19 kilometers per second. That's about 42,000 miles an hour, and it was not discovered in advance. The first sign that anything was happening was when the sky lit up. Indeed, there are about 10 million of these objects of this size in Earth-crossing orbits. That's many, many orders of magnitude times the number of objects that are 1 kilometer in diameter. There's about 1,000 of those. There's about 100 left that are undiscovered. The large ones hit the Earth on average about once every million years, but the Chelyabinsk-sized objects hit the Earth about once every 50 years. So there's a probability of about 2% that we'll have another one somewhere in the next year. Currently, we don't have a system that's designed to discover and track these things. Now, there really are two ways to prevent an asteroid catastrophe. One is deflection, mitigation, where you actually discover something way in advance and give it a little kick, give it a little delta V, so that over the years it will slightly drift where away from the orbit that it was originally on and miss the Earth. Another possible way to save lives is to find something weeks or even days in advance and get people out of the way. At Chelyabinsk, there were about 1,500 people that were injured, some of them very seriously. It's lucky that no one died. If we had seen that object coming even a day in advance, we could have issued a warning, we could have evacuated, or we could have at least told people to shelter in place, stay away from windows, and save lives that way. So one of the things I'm very concerned about is our lack of surveys for very small objects that are headed towards the Earth on their final death plunge. If we were able to do that, we could actually get some really interesting science out of it as well. It's happened by luck now three times in the last decade that an object was discovered on its final death plunge. The first time in 2008, an object called 2008 TC3, and it was observed by luck. The most recent object was not actually an asteroid, but a piece of space debris. It was called WT1190F in November on Friday the 13th. And that plunged into the Earth's atmosphere at exactly the time and place that it was predicted near Sri Lanka. And it was observed. It was observed with high-speed cameras. So there's very interesting, useful science that can come out of these observations, even for small objects that aren't dangerous. So if you're interested in reading about this, you can Google Death Plunge Asteroids. I wrote a little article about it for Astronomy Magazine that was published last summer. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now we're going to come back across the Atlantic, and this time we're going to Paris and ESA headquarters. And there on the line to speak to us is Franco Ongaro, who's the head of ESA ESTEC and director of technical and quality management. Franco.
Thank you, Stuart. Good afternoon to you all, and it's a privilege and a pleasure to be sharing with you. First of all, the enthusiasm in ESA to be associated with Asteroid Day this year. But even beyond that, the fact that Stephen Hawking himself has actually supported the Asteroid Day movement and gave us a statement, which I'm happy to read, that this year Asteroid Day coincides with the staging of the Starmus Festival, a unique debating forum for the future of humanity. Among the events planned at Starmus during this day, we will also commemorate Asteroid Day, which happens on the same date. So I think the Asteroid Day is becoming a larger and larger event, and as rightfully deserves. And I think my colleagues mentioned all that we're doing in making sure that we take our part in protecting the Earth and our fellow citizens against the odd asteroid on the collision orbit. First of all, to try and catch them, and later on to try and deflect them as possible. And of course, we do this in a global international cooperation, because it's a global problem, and we feel very strongly. Incidentally, it's also the opportunity to do some very exciting science on the origin of our solar system, and to develop some very useful technologies for the future. So I'm happy and proud that we're here today and that we'll be there for Asteroid Day. And thank you all for listening.
Thank you all for listening.
Thank you, Franco. Next, I hope we have a video from Amanda Sikafus from South of Africa.
Hi, my name is Amanda Sikafus, and I'm a planetary astronomer at the South African Astronomical Observatory, the SAAO, which is located in Cape Town, South Africa. Our observing site is Sutherland, which is a station that's about 350 kilometers northeast of Cape Town. We host a number of telescopes there, including the 10-meter SALT, the Southern African Large Telescope, which is run by an international consortium of partners, and then we have a number of other smaller telescopes from 1.9 meters down to a few tens of centimeters. There aren't many people in South Africa who do planetary science research. However, we have contributed to taking observations of asteroids. For example, we've measured light curves with SALT and thus derived the rotation rates of some asteroids. We've more recently begun to take broad band visible wavelength spectra of asteroids from SALT. And we have an ongoing program of photometry from the 1.9 meter to look at the colors of Trojan asteroids and learn a little bit more about their origin. There's interest in South Africa of becoming a place where near-Earth asteroids could be detected, and geographically we would be a very good complement to other detection sites such as the southwestern US and Hawaii. So, hello from South Africa, and thank you for inviting us to join this day. Happy Asteroid Day.
Thank you, Amanda. So it's time now for someone else here in ESTEC, and I'm pleased to introduce to you Dr. Detlef Koschny. He's the head of the Near Earth Object segment of the Space Situational Awareness Program here at ESA ESTEC. Detlef.
Thank you very much, Stuart, and good afternoon to everybody. I want to quickly introduce you to one of the activities that in the European Space Agency we are already doing related to all the work that we've been talking about, near-Earth objects or asteroids in general. So we have established something we call a near-Earth object segment in our Space Situational Awareness Program in the year 2008. So we started in January 2008. And our mission statement is that we should establish and support a European capability to protect basically us or our infrastructure from threats by potential asteroid impacts. We have, I call them pillars, three main pillars of activities. Well, the first thing is we talk about all these asteroids. The first thing you want to know, where are they? There may be some out there that are a danger for us. We don't know about them. There may be others that we do know. So the first thing is you need to detect them. You need to find them. For that, we need telescopes. That's pillar number one. Pillar number two is you need to find out where are they going. If I see all these asteroids and they never come close to the Earth, so what? I don't care. That's the second pillar. We have a center which we call Near Earth Object Coordination Center. In Italy, we work closely together with the University of Pisa. There we do orbit predictions. So we compute the orbits of all these objects 100 years in the future, and we find out whether they are a threat at all. Now, the third thing is, if you find out you have a threat, you need to tell the people, right? You, us, what we're doing here, but also emergency response agencies, decision makers. That's the political part, which was already addressed a bit by Tom. He was mentioning this International Asteroid Warning Network, the same page. We'll all be meeting in next week in Vienna in the margins of the Committee of Peaceful Uses of Outer Space meeting and discussing exactly the topic of today. So the European Space Agency has already some activities in this field. We need much more, of course, and that's one of the reasons why we are here today, to advertise and show you how important this topic is. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Detlef. Now it's time to hear from Brian May again. And this time, Dr. May will be introducing us to the ESA's asteroid impact mission.
I do have a particular personal fascination with asteroids. My own PhD thesis was based on the very smallest of these asteroids, the dust which inhabits the whole of our solar system and gives rise to the zodiacal light in the sky. I want to tell you about an experiment which will enable, for the first time, a human-made object to rendezvous with a binary asteroid. Why is this important? Why do we want to rendezvous with an asteroid? Well, we need to know what would happen if one of these asteroids hits the Earth. We need also to try and avoid that happening. And this experiment is actually to try and see what happens if you hit an asteroid with an object. Does it deflect it? It may very well do. That's the theory. But every theory needs testing. So we're talking about asteroid impact, but this is not doom and gloom. This is us actually doing something. And one day it could save all our lives, or our children's, or our grandchildren's.
Thank you, Brian. Well, AIM is an important mission here at the European Space Agency, and here to tell us more is ESA's AIM manager, Ian Carnelli.
Thank you, Stuart. Good afternoon. I'm very excited to be here today and talk about the asteroid impact mission and how it fits in the international environment. Let me bring you back about 15 years ago. ESA was asked to answer what is the role of space missions with respect to this topic. And we started looking at different mission concepts to, first of all, detect from space objects that are difficult to detect from the Earth, characterize them, and ultimately assess different techniques that can be used to deflect asteroids. Over the last 15 years, we have assessed a number of these concepts. I couldn't say virtually all, but a number of them. And the most promising one materialized in a concept that we call Don Quixote, so which was meant to demonstrate the kinetic impact of deflection technique. This concept over the years was further optimized together with our colleagues at NASA and APL from the John Hopkins University, became the asteroid impact and deflection assessment test. So AIDA is an international endeavor which comprises two spacecraft, one European spacecraft, the Asteroid Impact Mission, and DART, Double Asteroid Redirection Test. So what is this mission about? It's a mission under study that is leveraging on a very close encounter with asteroid Didymos that you can see on my back. It's a binary asteroid which will come close to the Earth in October 2022. Why is this important? It's important because it allows us to design a mission that is extremely effective and extremely efficient. We can reach it in only 1.5 years and be there in time to characterize this system by onboard instruments, but also microlander, that we have learned a lot how to deploy these systems thanks to the Rosetta experience. After we characterize the system, the DART impactor will impact the moon and change the orbit of the moon around the primary asteroid. This experiment will allow us to gather all the data that we need to develop such a system should an impact one day occur with the Earth and be ready to deflect such an asteroid. So we'll be able from this test in space to design a mission should it be feasible with another asteroid. Now AIM has three sets of objectives. It's not only asteroid deflection, but we'll also do extremely useful science and interesting science that my colleagues will talk about in a second. And we'll also develop techniques and technologies that are useful for future exploration missions. Now, we've been leveraging on a number of technologies that have been developed already in our science missions, in our technology missions, even in our telecommunication missions and telecommunication technologies. We'll, among others, prove that we can communicate with Earth with very high bandwidth laser communication system, but also do innovative exploration by using CubeSats that are so popular today in low Earth environment, but never being used in deep space. So AIM is really about technologies, science, and asteroid deflection. For more information, please visit the AIM website. I'm very excited to say that this mission is inspiring a number of generations in students and research institutes, and we're partnering today with Asteroid Day to even further this knowledge into universities and the public with a number of events that will be taking place on the 30th of June. So stay tuned. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Ian. Well, as you heard there, the science of asteroids and the deflection of potentially hazardous ones goes absolutely hand in hand. And so our next speaker is here to tell us a little bit about the science of asteroids. So I would like to welcome to the podium here Dr. Patrick Michel from the Côte d'Azur Observatory in France.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. I'm very happy to be here with you. So as a scientist, I would say that asteroids are fascinating. And they are fascinating because they are the remnants of the building blocks of our planets. And therefore, they contain key elements regarding our solar system and planet formation. And in fact, also space missions to asteroids are a great source of excitement for the public. If you think about Rosetta, every time you send a spacecraft to an asteroid, people easily identify to the spacecraft, this small robot, that tries to reach these challenging targets. It's like an adventure a la Indiana Jones. Then understanding the physical and compositional properties of asteroids is crucial if we want to answer fundamental science questions related to the origin of the solar system and the origin of our planets and possibly also life. Moreover, it's also very important if you want to design properly efficient mitigation strategies. So far, we already got a great amount of knowledge about asteroids. And actually, this book, which I edited with a few colleagues, so it looks like a self-advertisement, but it was just published in December, contains 950 pages, which summarize our current knowledge. So we don't start from nothing. We have good knowledge. However, there are many things that miss. In particular, we don't have yet any direct information regarding the internal structure and the subsurface properties of these asteroids, what we call the geophysical properties of asteroids. And also, we have a very poor understanding about how the surface of an asteroid, which has a very low gravity compared to the Earth, reacts to any external action, whether it is the deployment of a lander or an impact. And the ESA space project in collaboration between ESA and NASA and the AIMS spacecraft by ESA in particular will allow us to improve greatly our knowledge regarding these asteroid properties. Also, these properties and the knowledge of these properties also serve future missions like, you know, missions with humans to asteroids or any other mission who tries to interact with an asteroid. It will also serve greatly science because the current structure of asteroids is actually a tracer of their collisional and dynamical histories. And we need to know this if we want to draw scenarios of the solar system history. So finally, what I would say is that Asteroid Day, the success of this Asteroid Day is a great proof of the great potential of asteroids for public outreach, which hopefully will motivate young people for science and also increase the awareness of the people regarding the asteroid threat. So Observatoire de la Côte d'Azur is very happy to be partner of Asteroid Day. And I would say as a scientist that despite the fact that they cause a threat, some of them cause a threat, asteroids are our friends. So happy Asteroid Day.
Thank you, Patrick. Well, Asteroid Day is overwhelmed with support. And we have now for you a short video of some messages from some people who couldn't be with us today.
Hello, it's Scott Manley here from YouTube, a gamer, educator, and fan of Asteroid Day. Fly safe.
Hi, my name is Anusha Ansari, and I'm an engineer, also a space explorer, and an entrepreneur. I'm also one of the original signers of the Asteroid Day 100X Declaration.
Now, our next speaker is someone who knows quite a thing or two about the smaller bodies of the solar system. And it's Dr. Stefan Ulemetz from the German Aerospace Center in Cologne. And Stefan is the Philae project manager, so was there for every step, every bounce, dare I say, of the amazing landing of the lander on Comet 67P in November 2014. Stefan, over to you.
Yeah, hello to ESTEC. Hello to everybody who is listening to us. Rosetta is a fantastic mission investigating a comet, and Philae has performed, as you know, the first landing on a comet, which has this to do with Asteroid Day. Well, as you mentioned, comets are among the small bodies in our solar system. So if we learn about comets, about their physics, scientifically investigate them, but also from a technological point of view, this is very relevant for other small bodies like asteroids. So for instance, important information we got was that small bodies in the solar system look very different than we would expect them. When we saw the comet Churyumov-Gerasimenko, we were very much surprised not only by the bizarre shape, but also by its surface properties. With Philae, we were able to measure the strength of the surface. We were also able, with the radar instrument, with CONSET, to do some demographical measurements and get data on the porosity and internal structure of such a small body. And as we have learned more about the comets, small bodies, we can use this knowledge and also the technological skills we have gained for further investigations of asteroids. And one example, of course, is in the frame of AIDA and AIM, a small lander we plan to deliver to the moon of Didymon, called Mascot 2. There is a Mascot 1 with the Japanese Hayabusa 2 mission to an asteroid right now. And it will land on the moon and then, with a radar instrument, investigate the internal properties, the global porosity of the small body. And this, again, of course, is relevant in understanding how the deflection works. What's the reaction there? We will also get high-resolution images of the surface of this asteroid and thus better understand any kind of deflection experiment we can do. So small bodies in the solar system have to be seen as a family with very different members, whether it is the very primitive ones, like comets, probably the most primitive ones, or chondritic asteroids, or the more frequent S-type or even M-type asteroids. So I hope to have soon the chance to investigate with these missions really the reaction of an impact on such an asteroid, and that we are able to prove that in the case we really would have to deflect a dangerous astronaut, that we can demonstrate that this technology is available. Rosetta was a first step if it comes to our technologies, how to operate a spacecraft, how to land a lander on such a small body.
Hello, my name is Luca Parmitano. I am an Italian astronaut of the European Space Agency. I was commander of the underwater expedition NEMO, where we simulated human exploration on asteroids. The asteroid threat is a global endeavor that should be dealt with globally, engaging all spacefaring nations at every level, from education to research institutions to the space agencies. A lot of good progress has been achieved in the detection and characterization of these objects, and we should continue and even ensure that the effort is supported by more countries in the future. Asteroid impacts are the only natural hazard that we have good knowledge and on how to prevent. However, lots of unknown remains. It is time now for testing realistic mitigation techniques in space in an international cooperation frame. Asteroids tell us a lot about how our solar system has formed and ultimately where we come from. Scientific research should be fostered to deepen our understanding and to unveil the main unknowns that still remain. We need to improve our knowledge of the physical properties of the asteroids, and in particular those that may influence the efficiency of our mitigation or deflection strategies. For example, shape, rotation rate, internal and external structure. We also need a better understanding of how asteroids respond to external actions, like for example an impact, that will help us design efficient deflection tools. Asteroids are also tracers of the solar system's history, and collisions play a fundamental role in all phases of this history, from the planet formation era to the giant impacts like the moon formation era to the current period. Understanding the impact process at large scale can provide unique information for our understanding of the solar system origin and evolution, including our planet. The AIDA project represents the perfect example of an international collaboration to test and demonstrated that we can do something to mitigate the threat while achieving great scientific results at the same time, not only improving our knowledge about these small but fascinating objects, but also receiving additional clues about our own history. Asteroid Day is held each year on June 30th, which is the anniversary of the largest asteroid impact on Earth in recent history, the 1908 Siberian Tunguska asteroid impact. However, the recent event in Chelyabinsk in Siberia also, even if they're smaller, they remind us that we cannot ignore the issue. On Asteroid Day, people from around the world join together to take collective responsibility to change the course of human destiny through increased awareness and education of asteroids. So, thank you very much for your participation.
Thank you, Luca, and thank you, Stefan, before. Now, as we heard from Stefan, the Rosetta mission has been doing great things around the comet Churyumov-Gerasimenko. So here to tell us a little more about that is Dr. Richard Moisel from the Rosetta science team.
Hello, good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. So we've heard asteroids and comets, they may be a hazard to us sometimes. For sure, they're one of the key factors to learning more about the solar system and where life came from and everything. But yet, at the same time, we know very little about asteroids and comets compared to how much there is to know about them. Now, obviously, that's because they're so far away and so hard to observe. So what remains for us to really deeply learn about them and unlock the secrets of their creation and their evolution is to go there. That's what we are doing on Rosetta. We're going there, and every day is hard work in trying to conduct controlled scientific experiments and get the best data down there. Now, we will not only learn more about comets, asteroids by visiting them, about the objects we go to, but we'll also learn to better interpret how to the data we acquire through our telescope from Earth. So missions to asteroids and comets will benefit greatly the future of the science of these objects. And also, as we're going to step it one up with AIM in a certain respect by visiting a binary that is even more unpredictable in terms of the gravity field, in terms of the unknown surroundings of the object we are going to, we learn a lot more. For future missions, we learn for science, we learn for our own protection. So I'm very excited about what's to come there. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Well, our next speaker is Debbie Lewis. And Debbie's master's dissertation was entitled Near-Earth Objects, Imminent Catastrophe or Manageable Risk. Here to tell us a little more is Debbie.
Thank you, Stuart, and thank you, Grig, very much for inviting me along today to the press conference and for including contingency planning or civil protection as part of Asteroid Day, because it's not just about rocket science, although clearly that has an extremely significant part to play. With regard to the occurrence of the next asteroid impact event, it's clearly a case of when, not if. Previous incidents that have occurred, with the exception of Chelyabinsk, have been relatively benign. And as such, for me and the research that I conducted, that they are harbingers of future impact events. So the awareness needs to be raised in advance, as we as members of the general public are not familiar with this hazard occurring in our lifetime, and it's therefore outside of our experience. International arrangements for civil protection are clearly required as a contingency, along with the other risk treatment methods other risk treatment methods required for this hazard, such as characterization, planetary defense, and the research program. Humanitarian and political responses are also required in addition to the scientific and technical methods for deflection in order to mitigate this hazard. And civil protection protection arrangements are needed and need to be determined well in advance and considered at the same time as the scientific and the technical response. just in case, as I say, I just need to emphasize, just in case, in the unlikely event that the deflection methods fail. It's important not only to save people's lives, but it's also important to save their livelihoods as well. And currently, there is no time afforded, no time available for us in order to practice or to put consequence management arrangements in place. There is no time to prepare the population, no time to prepare the politicians, and equally the press. And there's no time to exercise these response arrangements that are required. So, which is why it is with great pleasure that I am pleased to announce that we will be running an exercise during Asteroid Day this year. And for more information on the exercise at the public event and for civil protection arrangements, Grig has very kindly let me have a blog on the Asteroid Day website. So please do log in for more information. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Colonel Chris Hadfield. I'm an adventurer, an explorer, and an astronaut. Flown in space 3 times, been around this beautiful, precious world of ours 2,650 times. And naturally, with that type of view of the planet and everything that surrounds it, I'm of course a supporter of Asteroid Day. We live in a cosmic shooting gallery. The Earth is hit by 100 tons of meteorites every day. Just recent revelations from the University of California in LA show that the moon was created with a cataclysmic crash of a planet into our planet Earth. And 110 years ago in Tunguska, and just a couple of years ago in 2013 at Chelyabinsk, and really any night that you look up and see the shooting stars in the sky, you're reminded that that we are constantly at a level of threat from bits of rock hurtling through our solar system. And some of them are big enough to do significant damage. And so what do you do about it? The threat is low, but the result can be extremely high. And we are now, for the first time in our history, at a level of technological capability to maybe detect and do something about the threat from asteroids. It's part of the legacy of this big brain and the level of quality of life that we've built all around the world, that we're now maybe at a point where we can start to deal with a threat like asteroids. And what makes Asteroid Day so successful is all of the volunteers and people becoming aware and everybody hosting activities all around the world, scientists and asteroid hunters and regular citizens. And I think everybody, especially today, should go to asteroidday.org and have a look and just think about the environment that we live in, about some of the threats that exist, about some of the things we can do about it, and what you might personally consider being a part of as a citizen of this world. Have a great day.
Asteroid Day is not just a name, it's a series of events that all take place on the 30th of June. In 2015, we had 2 premier events, one in London and one in California. This year, we have 6, 2 in Spain, 1 in South Korea, 1 in Austria, 1 in Chile, and 1 in the United States. Well, we want to encourage all of you as well, the general public, to organize events wherever you are. This is about coming together to raise awareness of near-Earth objects and the potential hazard that they pose. Now that completes the presentations for this conference this afternoon, and I want to once again thank the European Space Agency very much indeed for hosting us here. We're going to move into the question and answer session now, and in a moment we'll be opening up the floor here at ESTEC for questions from the journalists here. But if you're watching online, you can also submit your questions either via email to pr@asteroidday.org or using the Twitter hashtag asteroidday2016. So let's start off in the room. Who here has a question? We're going straight to the internet, it would seem.
Hello, we have a Hello, hello.
Sorry. We have a question that came from Jesse Impact of space.com. And he has a question about the yet unconfirmed report that a man may have suffered and died in India as a result of a possible meteor. And we were wondering if one of our panel could speak to that.
Detlef, can I pass that one to you?
Right. Okay, well, thanks for the question. Of course, a very relevant question. We did not arrange anything there. The knowledge that we have right now is that last Saturday, actually, so it's been a few days already, in the Vellore district, which is about 100 kilometers from Bangalore, there was a person killed, a bus driver, and there are reports that this was possibly caused by a meteorite. Now, meteorites drop on our planet 20 to 30 times per year. So this could actually be something that can really happen. This particular event, unfortunately, I think it's a bit too early to say anything about it. The reports that we received in our coordination center were such that they don't really indicate a meteorite impact or that the meteorite would have anything to do with the topic that's discussed there. I think it's too early. We have to really wait and see. There are people now locally out there that try to understand what's going on. And like in any crime scene, it just takes a bit of time to find out what really happened. I think that's as much as we can say. We don't really want to speculate, so I would like to leave it like that.
Actually, Stuart, there's a follow-up question. Of wanting to know what kind of systems are currently in place to monitor NEOs by any space agencies or organizations, and what concrete steps have they taken?
Okay, is there anyone of our speakers who wants to? Let's Detlef again. Just stay there.
Sorry about that. Okay. Well, to detect asteroids, we need survey telescopes that scan the complete night sky. And there are a number of systems. They're all funded by the US right now. So they're really leading the effort of surveying the sky, of finding out where these asteroids are. We are in Europe. We are currently developing a survey telescope. It's not yet there, but we will have a prototype ready next year. These surveys spent a lot of time to scan the complete night sky, so they focus on discovering the objects which are far away and which are large. We are aiming in Europe to contribute to that, a complementary system that scans the complete night sky once per night, that will then focus on the smaller objects which are close by and can be anywhere in the sky. A very important part in this whole question of how do we find out where the asteroids are is a community of not only professional astronomers but also amateur astronomers. Some amateurs have quite large telescopes. Once an object is discovered, you need to do something we call follow-up. So you need to make sure that you observe it again after 3 hours, after a day, after a week, to make sure that we don't lose it again. And I really want to mention here that amateur astronomers are still playing an important role, besides, of course, some professional institutions we are working with.
Should I just stay? Thank you. So we've got a question in the room here. So may I ask as well that just before you ask your question, you state your name and your affiliation, please.
Okay. My name is Robert Vogel. I'm a writer for the Periroden magazine. And you don't have to convince me that Asteroid Day is important. But I guess you expect us as citizens to talk to our government, do something about it. And governments have the habit to think about only in the time they have the power. Asteroid impacts are very nebulous danger. So what do you think has to happen to raise awareness about that? My personal theory, and I'm an optimist, but it may sound very cynical, is that you have at least a catastrophe in which several thousand people die before really something is happening. What do you comment on this?
So maybe our risk management expert, Debbie Lewis, would like to comment on this. And so the question is really, do we have to wait for a catastrophic tragedy before we can convince people to take this threat seriously?
Thank you, Stuart. And thank you for your question. The short answer is that no, we shouldn't have to. My sense is, my personal perspective is that were a large enough object be to identified, which would provide sufficient warning time, say sort of 10, 15, maybe even 20 years, then when we have an object in our midst that we have to prepare for, and again sort of in conjunction with the mitigation methods for deflection, then equally that's when I would hope, and maybe I'm being incredibly naive, but maybe that I would hope that that would be the event that would start to pull everyone together to raise the awareness, to actually realize that this is something that we can do something about, that the cost of mitigating against it is far better, or I wouldn't say cheaper, but at a cost than it would be. But equally, we need to think about civil protection arrangements. And certainly what I've seen so far in response to other natural hazards, like famine, storm, floods, that kind of thing, it seems to be very much a tented option, you know, sort of where they can do a mass deployment of survival tents. And I take nothing away from that, I commend that. But when I think we have sufficient time, we need something much, much more sustainable, much, much more robust. And as I mentioned earlier, that we need to protect not only lives, but livelihoods, because life has to continue. So it's a rather long answer to a question, but at the moment there isn't sufficient awareness, and I ask myself the same question: how many people do in fact have to lose their lives in order for this subject to be taken seriously? Because it's quite clearly taken seriously by the scientific community, we just need the rest of the world to catch up. So thank you.
I just want to follow up that question. I think it's a very relevant question. You know, first of all, I'm not a scientist, I'm a filmmaker, I tell stories. And, you know, for me it's really all about, you know, there's so many incredible scientists working in the field. What they need is us, you know, the sort of the storytellers, to kind of highlight what they're doing. Because most of them are too humble to go out there like this and say, hey, what we're doing rocks. So they need people like us, the storytellers. The organizers, you know, the people, you know, if you're out there right now watching this, and you might not be a scientist, you might be like myself, a storyteller, you might not have anything to do with storytelling or science or any of this, but you still feel passionate about getting behind a global issue that is hopefully, and I really don't think it's going to cause any huge harm tomorrow, but it could be in the future, and is one of those issues where we need a lot of time, because the last thing we want to do is get in a situation where we have to start panicking. That's the last thing we want to do. So we're not talking about a month, 2 months, a day, you know, and then we can send Bruce Willis. That's not the solution. Apparently he retired. I tried to get in touch with him. Bruce, if you're listening to this, get in touch. No, seriously though, there's no Bruce Willis, but there's actually some amazing people, a lot of them that are in the room that are doing the science, and we need to help highlight them. And I think that if we create enough noise, if we get out there on social media, if we create events all around the world, and tell our government leaders, our business leaders, it's not just government, it's private as well. If we tell them we care, we the human species are the first one that can actually do something about it, that can change the history of the solar system. And that's something really exciting, and I think that's something we need to highlight. You know, stop all the doom and gloom. It's not about that. It's about there's an opportunity, and we are the first species that can control our destiny. And that's a beautiful thing. And I think that's a message that we need to get across, you know, globally. And I hope that this year, and I'm very, very optimistic that this year will be even more successful than last. And it's just going to keep growing. And eventually, you know, the people that are making the decisions will wake up and say, oh, well, you know, there's a lot of people caring about this. Let's do something about it.
Excuse me, Greg, maybe you want to stay up there because I have a question for you. We got a question from Patricia Monteith, who wanted to know where she could find. She's an educator. Where she could find the resources for educators and others to use at local events, and will they be on the Astro Day website? And also, how will you be listing the events so that people can take advantage and attend them?
Yes, that's a very relevant question. So right now we're in February, and we are planning actually to say if you want to come here. So we're working with Ian Carnelli and the European Space Agency and Universe Awareness to put this together at the moment. Just basically keep an eye on the astroday.org website. We will let you know. Sign up to the newsletter. You will be the first to know. Watch out on social media. And I'm thinking, we said May, end of May. I think that's kind of where we were planning on putting it up. So plenty of time for you to download it. It's obviously free, and read it. I don't know, is there anything you want to add to it? No, that's all that sums it up. I just wanted to have hear somebody with me, so I'm not too nervous.
Okay, well, when asking questions as well, don't forget that we still have a number of our speakers online who were speaking to us on the video link earlier. So do we have another question in the room here? Yes, we do. In second row.
Hello, it's Sylvan Schoonhoven from the TMG newspapers. I have a question. I spoke to Mr. Koschny about a month ago, and he said something very intriguing. He said that he met on some conferences, he met some technicians from the military who claimed that they already had the technology to deflect asteroids by using nuclear devices. Which may be true or not, but maybe someone from the panel can comment on that. Is it, would that be possible already or not?
Ian, since you're... since you're responsible for AIM, perhaps you can tell us about...
Yes. Thanks for the question. As I said earlier, we have studied, and the scientific community at large has studied many deflection techniques. I actually invite you to visit the website of the Planetary Defense Conference, taking place every 2 years. It's now the 5th edition. Next one will be next year in Tokyo. It's a ever-larging community. Now, to summarize what takes normally a week of conference to go through is that ultimately there are three main concepts that are being looked at. One is indeed the nuclear option, one is the kinetic impactor, and one is the gravity tractor. Now, what we also think the consensus is that the kinetic impactor is the one which is most ready technologically to be used, and also makes, let's say, more sense to test because it's addressing the broader cases that we think could be prepared for. So the nuclear option actually is the option that would be addressing very large asteroids, for which we know today that the likelihood of impact is extremely low, if not null. Or asteroids that we can detect at the very last moment. So the time to impact is extremely short. And in that case, I would link to what Mark Boswell was saying before. Today, we don't have so many means to detect those kind of asteroids. So if you consider the ones you can actually detect and do something about it, the kinetic impactors today seems to be the one that we prefer, and that's the one we're preparing for technologically.
Thank you, Ian. I'm wondering whether any of our online guests would like to come in on that and make a comment. If you do, raise your hand and we'll get you up on the screen. Don't be bashful. There, Mark, there we go.
Okay. One of the reasons we want to discover objects far in advance is so that we can avoid using nuclear explosions to deflect them. The more time we have, the less likely we'll need to resort to that. If an object is discovered well in advance, even a very large object, we can use a kinetic impact to deflect it, and in fact, possibly multiple kinetic impactors or a gravity tractor. So while I guess the original question was, is the technology ready for nuclear deflection? No, it's not. That does require a lot of development still, and that development is underway, but it's unlikely that we'll actually be testing it in space. So if we do discover something that requires that technology, it'll be used for the first time to deflect that asteroid.
Thank you. Do we have another question in the room? Sir, you again.
So let's assume for a moment we have such an emergency. Who is responsible for doing something? United Nations? United States? Is there an international consensus about who's doing what in that case?
Yes, so let's look again at our online participants. Is there anybody who wants to talk about who is responsible, the international response for this? If not, then you know who I'm going to ask. Doreen, are you there? Can you answer that one?
Listen.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Now do you listen?
Yes.
It's okay. So, actually, the United Nations organized two advisory groups. They are not action groups. They are advisor groups to advise international community, governments, institutions on what do we discover and what do we have to do. It's up to the governments to decide the measures inside each country at this level. Of course, if we develop this activity at a higher level, we take the decisions at the international level. We establish exactly who could be responsible at this level. But for now, each government is responsible for the measures in its own country. Don't forget that we have institutions, even at the level of ESA. Detlef Koschny is there, is representing such an institution, that determine what happened, what measures we should take. But they are not responsible for the actions now.
Okay, so we had a technical hitch there. Well, let me just say something from my perspective then, as a science journalist who's been covering this particular topic for over two decades now. And that is that you're right. Governments do move slowly. There is an unwillingness for one single government to take this on of its own. But in the space of time that I've been covering this story, I have seen significant movement of positions. And yes, governments move slowly, but I think they are moving and moving in the right direction. And it's thanks to the endeavor of people here today, all our speakers and the general public who supported Asteroid Day last year and will do so again this year, that it's keeping this high on the agenda and the public profile of this hazard. Do we have any other questions? Yes, so it was in the back row there, the hand went up first.
Hi, sorry. Hi, I'm Dr. Carpinetti from IFL Science. My question is, given unlimited funding, what should be the first priority for, should it be deflection of asteroid, observation, more missions?
Okay, so Patrick, do jump in.
I would say never say to a scientist that you have unlimited funding. First, if you have that, you need both. Because what we do to address this problem is actually the two things. You need to make the inventory of all the objects down to ideally a few tens of meters. But even 100 meters, and that can be done in space, actually the foundation Basics 12 has a project to do so. And that can be done if you put a satellite in the orbit around Venus, and you can discover most of the objects within 5 years, including the follow-up. And that costs a few hundred of millions, if you want, which is actually seems big, but it's actually just 1 or 2 days of Iraq war. So it's not that big. And of course, once you have done the inventory, or even at the same time, if you could do it ideally, or before, no matter the order, you also know to know your enemy. So that's a characterization plan. That's the plan of AIM and AIDA, is to understand how these bodies respond to, you know, any mitigation plan, and what are they are made of, so that you can best prepare the next plans. So I think these are the two priorities if you have, as you say, unlimited funding. And I think that we need to go to space for that. So basically, you could do the inventory from the ground. We have a LSST, the telescope that will allow us to multiply by 10, essentially, the amount of discoveries. But if you want to go faster, you can do it from space, and again, for not so much budget. And the other part, you need to go to space. And in fact, even from the ground, you always have limited information. So you can have the size, the sense of the shape, but you don't have the density, you don't have the internal structure, you don't have even the detailed surface properties. You can infer that maybe there is a sand or something like that, but you are not sure. So you need to go to space. So that would be my answer. Just want to go back also about the question, how we can increase the awareness to the politicians. So I don't believe also that we need to have people die for that, hopefully. I also don't believe that convincing the politician that the threat is important will really work, because as you said, the politician, they look at timescales of a few years, and the threat hopefully is not before a few tens of years or even centuries. So I think we have to play the different aspect of asteroids, and that's a good advantage of asteroids, that they can be served as a tool for many things. As a scientist, I would say science, and we have actually two sample return missions to asteroids, Hayabusa 2 and OSIRIS-REx from JAXA and NASA, that will arrive at the asteroid in 2018 at the same time. So here, in 2018, there will be, as we say, a buzz, because we'll have two main agencies on an asteroid, and that will help us also to have the public excitement. The politician will be aware of it. I hope the media will cover that, the storytellers too, and this is very important. So already existing projects like Rosetta, OSIRIS-REx, Hayabusa 2, when we, the media talk about it, and the people are really excited that it was for Philae, that really helps us. And then also asteroids are tools like, they can be used as resources. We have now private industries interested to mine asteroids. So if you ask me, I don't believe that can be done easily in a few years, even a few decades, and to make business is even more difficult. But it's true that in maybe a few centuries, you really need that. We also have human exploration. NASA has this asteroid retrieval mission, which is now under study. So you have different reasons to be interested in asteroids. So we shouldn't focus on only one. We have this advantage that we can have many, many domains that are interested into asteroids. So we need to convince the various people who are interested in each topic to increase the excitement. And that also depends on you, because at the end, I can write books, I can do whatever I want, I'm just a scientist. You, the journalists, are the ones who are the mostly read. So we need your support, and please come to us, we can explain you what it is, so that you can write good articles and hopefully help us in our cause.
Thank you, Patrick. Now, the most impressive part about that answer was how quickly he got to the microphone when he heard the words unlimited funding. Did you notice that? So we have time for just one more question now. Then it's time for one-on-ones with the journalists here in the room. So that being the case, is it possible that we have an online question from our audience to finish? If we don't, we can certainly go back to the room.
And then I do think we have one more question from the audience that someone would like to answer. But this is from Janice in the United States, and she would like to know what kind of science someone should study in order to be able to join solution makers.
Okay, so Tipsy? No? Who wants to talk about what kind of science should be studied to help in this endeavor? Patrick, from the scientist himself.
Well, any kind of science, I would say. This is, again, the great thing about astrophysics in general, planetary science and asteroids, is that if you are interested in any kind of physical processes, in any case, they all happen on these bodies. Okay, for asteroids, maybe electromagnetic fields are a little less important, although we don't really know. So I would say if you and you should be interested in science, then choose whatever you want. There is a lot of things to understand. Asteroids are rocks, so you could say mechanics, rock mechanics, or even structural mechanics, whatever. They also, you know, go into orbit around the sun, so celestial mechanics is also very important. Dynamical systems, because actually these nearest asteroids have chaotic evolution. Same thing like in economy, in weather forecast, etc. So even dynamic system dynamics is very important. And even thermal properties are very important. Spectral properties, so if you are interested in spectral characteristics, etc. So I would say just take the field you want, and there is room for everybody. And it's also about social science, as we know. So even people not interested in the exact science can have a room. And of course, space design, because we need space missions, and any aspect on space design is also important. So I would say, please be motivated, because this is very exciting. The great job, the great thing about scientists is, you know, we do theories. And the first time our theory is confirmed by an observation, this is something that cannot even be told in words. So if you want to one time have this feeling, come.
Thank you. Okay, so so there was then one last question. I don't know whose it was, but I was just told there was one last important question that had to be asked.
Thank you. My name is Remco Timmermans. I represent the International Space University. And my question is really about Asteroid Day itself, because last year we had this incredible movie that we could show at our Asteroid Day events, and I happened to host one last year at the International Space University Space Studies Program. The difficulty with these activities is that it's very difficult to reach out to people who may not yet be interested, or who have not maybe necessarily heard about the asteroid threat. And my challenge as a communicator is to reach beyond the people that sit in the room and maybe the people that are sitting in the live stream. What is it this year that we can offer the audience such that we reach these millions of people that we would really like to reach with this message?
To answer this is the person that made that fantastic movie last year, 51 Degrees North, and that's Grig Richters.
52 degrees North, that's Hamburg.
Germany, no, we want to leave that place alone. I'm still working on, there's going to be most likely, don't tell anyone yet, a free version of the film, 51 Degrees North, yeah. So basically, there's going to be a free version of the film for anybody. It's going to be a slightly different version than we had last year, and we know to keep it fresh. And it's going to be available to anybody who's willing to keep their events free of charge. Because one of the things, obviously, you know, Astro Day is obviously nonprofit. If there is an event organizer around the globe who wants to organize an event free of charge and you want to show a movie, then please get in touch. Go to the astroday.org website, get in touch with info@asteroidday.org, email. And there's going to be other exciting activities. This year we're going to have an educational toolkit, which I think is going to help a lot, especially for teachers and educators. They can download the PowerPoint presentation end of May on our website. We will obviously advertise this, and they can slightly modify it for their classrooms or whatever places they want to present this at. And there's some other exciting things, that we're working on. Unai talked about discovery. And Ian, do you want to say something?
Thanks, Greg. Indeed, we're also working as ESA with a lot of scientists in industries. And one of the things, there are many projects that we're getting ready for the June events. One of which is a presentation you can download, open source presentation, which is describing the asteroid world in all its features, from detections to the properties, how they relate to the solar system formation. It includes images you can use. It includes animations. So all of these will be made. It's being prepared, and then it will be made available for download through the Asteroid Day website, but also ESA website. We're also working on different movies you'll be able to download on the Asteroid Impact mission, of course, but also covering different aspects of it. And these you can download from ESA website. Some of these movies can be used also, are formatted for planetariums, and you can show them in a planetarium. Some of them will be 3D. So I think there will be enough material for you to download and to get your event organized. Thanks.
Actually, one last point. I'm so sorry. I can just sort of like lean over here. Yeah, one last point really is, you know, like we said, last year, you know, was a great success considering that at that point we'd only been around for 7.5 months, 6.5 months, sorry. And, you know, one of the things that really we rely on, not just about the amazing toolkits and the educational materials, but like you also said, you know, we need to reach people that aren't aware of this. That's where partners like Universe Awareness come in, sorry, and Discovery. But also, you know, we're going to obviously ask all of our supporters to tweet about it and get it out to some folks. One thing that was really exciting right now on Twitter, actually, that I saw is, you know, some Queen fan club was saying how exciting this live stream was. So, you know, it made me very happy because these are not the folks, I mean, I'm sure a lot of them are very interested in asteroids, but some of them might not be as much interested. And, you know, so it shows that, you know, we're reaching people that would usually not really think about this. Yeah. So, yeah, thank you so much, Stuart.
Okay, well, I'm going to bring this to a close now with just some thanks. And it's a very, very big thank you to all of our speakers today, both here at ESTEC and online across the world. And that goes to our audience, too, to all of you here in the audience at ESTEC today and our viewers online. Remember, this is not just a name, it's an actual day of events. So join us on the 30th of June this year and visit us online at asteroidday.org. Thank you all very much indeed.